A bit close up of her nose.
Yeah, she's looking very.
Is that if you need a man?
Oh, man.
A good looking one, Norman.
That's me.
Oh, very nice. Oh, yes, fine.
Yeah, they take hours of it, you know. There's no editing facility.
There's no what facility. No, don't leave me alone. Don't do that. I'm just not on the land.
Keep your tongue there. Thank you.
Into somebody now, I'm quite sure. What? She's got herself a man. No, it's all right.
Hi.
Oh.
Certainly. That's good.
Not because it goes cock either. I can't actually see anybody. Hello! Honey Joan! Hello! I'll do a close up of that. That's right, she's gone, she's gone.
Just kind of the first time I did it. You can repeat it.
Yes, I'm getting all of it.
Another event that took place nearly 50 years ago and has proved to be long-lasting and has been appreciated by many and has had an impact on many, was the marriage of Joseph Henry Scott and Doreen Martin Wilson on the 6th of September 1944 in Ben Cran. Is that right? And being a son, I'm delighted to say that. Somebody else will be speaking today. But I want to take you back even before that to 1933. That's 61 years ago.
Yeah,
when, like the circus, the Scott family came to Whitehead. And Dad and his family turned up for the first time in our sector, part of the area. And joined the Whitehead community. And sometime between then and 1944, Dad and Mum got together. Now, if you picture the scene, there was Dad with his soft Irish brogue, which he somehow managed to maintain, and his cap, or his kip, as he would call it, his hair parted in the middle. A bit of a reputation for a salmon poacher. And I don't know if man about town would be the description, but he was there. And there was Doreen Wilson, surrounded by brothers and sisters, the youngest unmarried daughter of the Wilson Mafia. And in fact, the very fact that the two of them got together was a triumph over adversity, let alone that they got married. However, they did, and it was one of these situations where, well, you know the story, some enchanted evening, you will see a stranger. So it happened, they got married, and then they went into marriage. And my understanding is, being only a mere 22 years married, the first 25 years of marriage are when you suffer all the sort of physical ailments that you normally associate later on. There's amnesia, which is usually illustrated by, how many times do I have to tell you? There's the hearing problem of, why don't you speak up so the whole street can hear? And obviously there's the relationship where, well, she's your mother. But they've gone through that and they're now into the second 25, and soon to start the third 25. And they're doing it with grace, if that's the best way to describe that. The other thing I want to say before I propose the toast is keeping politics very firmly out of all this. I was talking to Carolyn earlier, and Mum and Dad got married in 1944 at the end of a world period of turbulence before the end. And their 25th anniversary would have been 1969, when we in Northern Ireland entered the period of turbulence. And with luck, their 50th is maybe the start of a period of quiet again. So it's somehow mirrored things that have gone on throughout Northern Ireland. So my toast is in four parts, so would you take your hand out? That was only the preamble. Part reflecting the role of my parents. The first part is to Joe and Doreen, who in 1944 got married, and joined and expanded that wonderful generation of the Wilsons and the Scots and the Hills and the Coopies and the Skeltons and their friends who formed sort of our families and bore our relationships, etc. So the first part is to Joe and Doreen. The second part is to Uncle Joe and Auntie Doreen on behalf of all the nieces and nephews for their listening ear, advice, endless cups of tea, driving lessons,
yes.
Grass cutting, and generally being about the place. The third part of the toast is to Grandma Joe and Grandma Scott on behalf of the next generation, irrespective of bloodlines or anything else, for again the listening here, but more especially for the sheer pride that they take in their grandchildren. And And the fourth is for Mum and Dad, from Carol and I, for everything. So I ask you to stand now, raise your glasses, and Joe and Dorothy.
Thank you very much indeed for turning up. You certainly made Dorn and my day. And I give you all a hearty welcome. I was talking a bit, but I didn't know what was the reason why not.
Burgers.
And to be here with us today, I'm delighted. I think she's filming me. And then I've only one accolade at all for today. That's surprising. And that's to Jack Briggs. I never believed that he could get Rosemary here.
Thank you.
dragged on here and there. But the first solid shock that I got when we were making crumbs, she said to me, could I ask you something? To do something? I said, certainly, anything you like, dear. Could you change your hair? And there, I could be still like Scott. It's a great day, there's no doubt about it. It's a joyous day for us. And I'm not going to pay tribute to Dorian, because she knows how it feels. I remember that breakfast, wedding breakfast, the 6th of September. By the way, it was pouring cats and dogs that day too. I don't know that, whether that accounts for the rain today. But I remember getting up at the wedding breakfast and stammering a few words, and I said something to the effect of, I think I'm the luckiest man in the world. And quite honestly, that luck has never run out. You know, it's gone terribly big. 50 years is a long time. In fact, at times it sends shivers down the back and I think the way life is flying past us. But thinking back to that day, it was a memorable day, because as John mentioned, we decided to have a quiet wedding by special license, and it cost us £20. And we had it in Benfran, and the Reverend John McNutt was the Methodist minister, and of course he was officiated. And funnily enough, soon afterwards he defected to the Church of Ireland. I don't think our wedding had anything to do with that. But anyway, we gathered into the lounge, and the idea was Dorian would come down the stairs. And I remember this vividly because it had a tremendous effect on me. It destroyed me, his memory. I was all amazed, you know, radiant, tight and tight and everything. And John McNutt stood beside me, and we stood and stood. And then people said, "Where's Dorian?" And John McNutt saw that I was starting to wither, you see, and he said, "Oh, she's, I don't know, maybe she's getting interesting." We can't even remember either of us what's in the dress, because remember that was rationing. And that's why I had to wear my own dunk shirt. And suddenly, her father appeared. That was the first I saw. And Dorian on her arms. And I said, "There is the radiant look." And tears were down her cheeks. And I was staggered, stunned. And I remember John McNutt putting his arm on the other, just distinctly saying, "Steady, steady." Because believe you me, I believe this day, and I'm saying this frankly, if that front door had been open, I'd have been on the side of you. Up to the Venice Hotel, you know, which is now the butcher place, and they scrambled the breakfast for us, a wartime breakfast, which wasn't much, but the best they could do. And then we repaired to the platform to get on the train, and we made a better job than that than we did with poor old Marion's time. When she got married, I went on the train to help Marion with a big suitcase, and the train started to move. I was nearly away, and John was still away. I was nearly away with Marion. John, come on! But anyway, that was all. We got to Dublin, and then we drifted across to. We got a bus out to Dunleary to the Royal Marine, and that was fabulous, but no doubt whether it was a honeymoon or not, the food was terrific. And after dealing with the deer rations for But the whole idea, Noreen and I had, we didn't want to be regarded as honeymooners. We were putting on a great act, and we were probably kidding ourselves not to be regarded as honeymooners in the hotel, which was crowded. But there was a dear old lady who used to sit at the next table to us. And when she was a full-time resident, and she got into chatting and she discovered where we're from and what we had endured and the ration and all she wanted to know. And I never heard such a bit of bluffing as we did. We didn't know the price of landing. She asked me the price of everything and what the cost of this and much more to get. And we bluffed away and we didn't know what we were talking about. But we felt we had convinced her because the second day before we left, she leaned over to us and the gentle voice said, if you look over at the fifth table over there, the young honeymoon couples. So we felt we had done the job. The only other, no, we got back to the Croft in Whitehead and we had a happy time, but that was only in September 1944. The war is still turning in our favour. But we enjoyed our residence and we enjoyed it very much. And when it came to Christmas time, which was only a few months after the marriage, Doreen said, what do we do about Christmas lunch? And I said, we're staying on our own. We're going to have our first Christmas dinner and we're going to have our own turkey. And we bought the turkey and we convinced the rest of the family that we'd be on our own for Christmas lunch. And Doreen did the needful, prepared everything, and we set out the table in the big lounge in the Croft and Beach Road. And baronial style, and a chair at that end, and a chair at this end. And now, I think we gathered a wee bit of silver for the middle. I don't know whether we did. But anyway, the crucial time came. Doreen announced the turkey was ready, but I said, bring it in. I'm on the carpet here, on my own style. So I got the carpet knife up and so on. And we just started off, and I got the first. No, I was trying to sever the leg, that was it, and I wasn't making much of a job. When we heard, yo-ho, and our then minister, Reverend Dr. Stewart, walked in to pay us the visit, and destroyed our Christmas dinner, the night of the turkey, or night him, and it turned out with a great roaring fire with a little concern of coal, and he said, I'll just sit here till you finish your lunch. There for the whole lunch. But those are the little things that come back to mind. The only other one, and I must be brief on this, the only other little incident, which at that time was of great significance to me, but now, of course, fades in the background, was Doreen had, I don't know how she had worked it, but she had presented me with a lovely signet ring after the wedding. I was very proud of this, but I didn't realise that it was a bit loose. And we'd only been married about 3 weeks, and suddenly one day, no ring. And I thought this was sufficient for a divorce action. I was really worried stiff about it. But then I remembered that she had talked to me about being in Manili's, the jewellers in Lombard Street, as it was then. So, when I went up to Parliament Buildings the next day, I said to the boss, could I have a half day of a bit of domestic business to attend to? So I ran down to the side gates, onto the old tram, and trotted into the town, round to Lombard Street, rushed into Manili's, and there was a girl behind the counter, and I said, Mr. Manili, and yes. He came out, so I told him my story. Oh, he said, no trouble. I'll get to your tree and pick what you think it looked like. So he brought out the tray and I picked the ring and I said, yes, that's it. So he got one that fitted me fairly tightly. Now I said, it was nicely engraved. Well, he said, there's a bit of paper, you trace out the engraving and I'll do it. So I traced it out as best I could remember. And he said, call back in an hour. Years afterwards, I decided to reveal this to her about the loss of the ring. And she said, where did you go, Manili's father, well, he got it in McDowell's. So I've never got back to Bristol. Well, we've had a happy time together, and I could never pay enough tribute to Jordan, because unfortunately, as some of you know, it's funny looking around and think how many have emerged in life since that. There's very few here that were alive then. So, my poor brother John was killed the next year, and then my father died because of the shock of that. Dory moved with me readily back with my mother, but unfortunately then she took severe rheumatism, and for the last 5 years she was bedridden, and Dory reared the two children and looked after my mother like a full-time nurse. And my mother had the happiest 5 years, those 5 years. She really had a happy time. Dorian never complained of the road she was carrying. But when I talk about the two children, John and Carolyn, and my other children, I pay a public tribute to them, because they've rallied round us all this time, caring and protecting us, looking after us, worried about us, and they're a really amazing family, and I thank them. And the whole family, Bill and Norman, and all of us concerned about it, bringing us up, having us in, and what we do with it. I think that's what our longevity is due to, quite honestly. But there it is. And all I conclude by saying that we've had a lot of happiness from dear friends of ours down the years, and our relations. And thank you all for coming and joining us today and making it such a happy occasion. Thank you very much.
And I just want to thank them with my whole heart for all they have meant to me. Thank you very much, Jeremy.
Thank you.